today, this entire this particular season of Management Masterclass essentially starts today with a session on Introduction to Design Thinking. So the key takeaways from today's session for all of you, right, would be first of all, an introduction to design thinking as a way of thinking and looking at the world. You know, solving complex problems by using design thinking, understanding how core management knowledge along with design thinking helps companies to navigate better and overcome complex issues. Design thinking is essentially a solutions-based approach to solving problems. It's an iterative, non-linear process, a way of thinking and working. Design thinking provides a simple way to hone in on exactly what the problems are, often discovering a different way of thinking about them, while also providing insights and data that are critical to building appropriate solutions that make a business a lot of money. Design thinking provides management students with a process to tackle complex problem-solving situations and to facilitate innovation. As such, it provides a much-needed supplement to the analytic emphasis seen throughout much of business education. Incorporating design thinking in the business curriculum is meant to provide students with a framework for dealing with unstructured problems and for managing the innovation process. The best real-life example of implementing design thinking is by Apple, which has always used design thinking in its approach. Their focus has been on craft, empathy, focus, and simplicity. As a result, Apple products to this day are the most user-friendly in the market, right down to the packaging. Design thinking has turned Apple into what is known as a market disruptor. So to give you more insights into the field of design thinking, as well as answer your queries, we have with us very eminent experts from academia as well as the industry. Pleased and privileged to introduce Professor Vijay Ghai, the Professor of Design Thinking at Soil Institute of Management, Gurgaon. Professor Ghai is deeply committed to the philosophy and practice of design thinking and its application to solving real life issues. He actively consults about this topic and has been evangelizing its application in business for competitive differentiation and for social impact since 2015. He teaches at some of the best management and engineering institutes across India as well as South Asia, including HULT, IMD, Great Lakes, and MDI. After a 26-year career, Professor Ghai took early retirement in 2015 from NIIT Technologies Limited. He last served as the Senior Vice President, Head of Strategic Initiatives, Consulting, and Advisory Services. Some of the other significant positions he has held include Chief Innovation Officer, Head of E-Business Consulting, Global Head of Retail Practice, and Head of Quality. Professor Ghai graduated as a mechanical engineer from Delhi University in 1981 and joined Hindustan Unilever in India back then, designing and building high-speed packaging and processing machines for in-house use by applying principles of human-centered design and engineering.
Thank you, Vimalji. This was a wonderful introduction. Thank you so much for being generous with your words. It's indeed an honor and a pleasure to be here with you and your
yes,
students.
Indeed.
And let's hope that this time that we spend together is beneficial. You know, the introduction that you've given actually is a very good summary of all that I was planning to say. So you introduced the topic very well. And I'm also glad that you have a follow-up session in more detail a couple of days from now. So the students will get a more complete
correct
understanding, much beyond where we will leave them today. Now, I don't want students to sort of get bored looking at my face. So let me, something else is really the reason why we thought we would focus on design thinking today. Why I am so passionate about design thinking. There are three reasons why this session today is important. And I'll give you our reason first, you know, why we decided that this would be an important topic to discuss. You know, design and design thinking used to be hidden in some studios somewhere. You know, it used to be hidden away in design studios and nobody ever wanted to share how it was done. And this was still a few years ago. And then as we approach the present, we find that design thinking has become center stage. And in today's conditions, it is now becoming main stage. You know, there is so much being talked about, so much being asked about, so much that people are expected to know that we thought this is a topic that really should have the students understand as they go into the field. And as you rightly said, you know, this is an augmentation. It adds on to the capability of the student. It doesn't take anything away. So whereas all the other methods that students have learned in their management education are still going to be useful, this in some ways fills up the gaps. This was the reason why we thought we would go ahead with this session. So this was really our reason. But I want to look at this now from the student's perspective as well. Now I'm calling this your reason. This is now addressed to all the students. You know, your reason is that as we step towards the end of the year 2020 and step into 2021, many things have got reset. You know, many things have, which we took for granted, are no longer true anymore. And therefore, in the minds of the students, there is a certain amount of fear. And this fear is not because of anything other than they don't know what to expect. This fear is the fear of the unknown. And this is the fear that we really want to address today. Because while this fear is natural, it need not consume you full time. And so let's step back a little bit further. Let's go back 5 years from now. Let's look at ourselves in 2015. And let's imagine that here you were, with your dear loving father. And as would normally happen at that time, the elders and anybody you're sitting across with, any sort of elderly relatives would come to visit you. One question they would always want to ask is, where do you see yourself 5 years from now? And when you apply for a job, rest assured, this was one question that every single employer would also want to know. Where do you see yourself 5 years from now? Now imagine if you had recorded your answer to this question 5 years ago in some notebook somewhere, and you looked at yourself today, now here we are into 2020, how valid would the answer be? It is this sudden shift that has happened, you know, between what we thought would happen and what has really happened, that makes it worth your while to try and understand what this topic is all about. So we were all preparing for something, and we suddenly don't know where all that preparation has gone. Is it even valid today? And our reason really, you know, your reason really to be attending this question is to understand what next. Because there is a lot of uncertainty, and let's accept that. There's no point running away from it. Let's accept that. There is uncertainty. We don't have all the answers. What is equally interesting is that when Forbes, you know, organization like Forbes contacted the world's top leaders and asked them what next, then we had business leaders of 2020 ask the same question, what next? Global leaders, people we understood and respected. And then we contacted over 150 of the HR leaders from India, asked them what next. Guess what they said? Even we don't know. So I want to put your mind at rest. If you are afraid of not knowing what's coming in the future, you're not alone. The best of the industrialists, the best of the minds, the best of the brains don't have the answer. And so, as we step further, I'm now going to give you an even bigger reason, an even bigger, much more significant reason to try and understand what this session is all about. The real reason is this little planet that we inhabit. And people of my age, people of my vintage, unfortunately, have been responsible for making a real mess of this world. And what we are giving to you as an inheritance is a completely messed up world. It's messed up in every single respect, socially, economically, environmentally, you name it, and we've messed it up. And in this messed up world, guess what? People like us have forgotten that everything is connected. You know, we have been taking piecemeal solutions to problems. We've been saying, let's isolate this problem, handle it as a standalone. It doesn't work that way. Real life doesn't work that way. And if you look at where our world is right now, we've realized everything is connected. You take a decision for something today, it affects something else, somewhere else, and so on and so forth. And nowhere has this been made more evident than in the spread of the coronavirus. You know, the rapidity with which it spread has taken everybody by surprise, everything by surprise, and how everything got connected so dramatically that no one country could isolate themselves from the other. And this is the power of connectivity. So while connectivity is good for us, it's also making sure that everything gets multiplied exponentially that much faster. And this is the complexity and the uncertainty that we have to deal with. Do all this, what do we expect you to be? We expect you to be optimistic and confident. And we expect you to be happy and energetic. Ask your parents. They say the only thing we look for you are for you to be happy and energetic. So the least that we can do while giving this mess to you on a platter, the least that we can do is to help you to at least get equipped a little bit better to handle this world that you're inheriting. So we created all the mess. We are really sorry for it. And if we didn't do something about it, I think that would be cruel. So at least for my area of expertise, you know, let's offer you one small tool. It's not the tool, it's a tool that will hopefully help you to navigate this world a little bit better. So let's look at the real reason. The real reason why you should attend the session is because we want to convert this fear into fuel. And how we will do that, here is a summary of the entire session. We do that by looking at every challenge as an opportunity. So don't look at this as a problem that you're facing. Good Lord, you know, the world is all a completely messed up place. What if you can turn it around and say, wow, the world is really messed up. This is something which I can now do something about. So turning this negative into a positive energy is really the purpose of having a session like this. And so when Corona shut down the whole world, you know, all the people we were working with, we said, wow, this is the best time to be alive. So when everybody else was saying the world is shutting down, the market is shutting down, the businesses are shutting down, you know, homes are shutting down, migrants are creating, you know, they're facing huge amount of problems. Politically, it's a disaster. Environmentally, it's a disaster. We said, fantastic. Look at all the opportunity that exists for us to make a difference now. So instead of looking at it negatively, the first shift that happens with design thinking is the shift to say there is no problem, there are only opportunities. And if by the end of the session, the only thing that you remember is that every opportunity that exists today is because a problem existed somewhere, you would have changed your attitude towards the future as it unfolds. So when a world is turned upside down, it enables a very interesting thing to happen. It allows us to look at the world differently because the world has changed. Now, if you expect the world to continue to be what it was earlier, it won't happen. You know, then you're living in the past. Today, the world has changed. So can we change the way we are looking at it? Can we see what has changed? Can we see what is new? Can we see what we thought was existing which is not there anymore? It's just disappeared. The moment you become sensitive to let's see what's different now, you have become a better design thinker. So we are familiar with problems, you know, the kind of problems we've grown up with. We had these problems in physics, and I'm sure those of you who've done economics and other subjects have similar problems. The moment we saw a familiar problem, we said, aha, this problem I know, I've solved it 30 times, I know exactly what the problem is. And so we expect the world to be very familiar. It doesn't happen like that. Let's look at another very, very familiar problem. A problem that is not more than, you know, something that you solve maybe in the third standard, fourth standard, maybe by the fifth standard. It looks so obvious we can solve it like this, but try solving this problem right now. What answer did you get? Now, if you got an answer of one, you're correct. If you got an answer of 16, you're also correct. So the same problem has two answers. A very obvious, very straightforward problem has two answers. Just because depending on what we've grown up with, what kind of mathematical principles we've grown up with, one or the other applies. Do you do multiplication first or do you do division first? So this is where something which is very familiar now suddenly starts giving you more than one answer. And then you had puzzles that we've been solving, like the Rubik's Cube, so many different ways of solving it. Everybody has their own. And then you have the brain teasers, you know, where something which is obvious, you take it for granted. And then there's a little bit of a twist. So your mind is telling you, half an hour between the pills, three pills, 1.5 hours. Answer is very straightforward. But if you really think about it, it's not really 1.5 hours, it's just 1 hour. Similarly, a truck driver is going down a one-way street. The assumption here is truck driver has to be driving a truck. The truck driver is not always in the truck. He could just be walking down. And if he's walking down, a one-way street doesn't really matter, does it? So Abhinav has, his father has four sons. So your mind is telling you 10, 20, 30, 40. What's the next obvious answer? It's 50, right? So our mind tends to fall into patterns. And when your mind falls into patterns, you miss something which is obvious. And so consciously, you have to look for something which is different in this situation right now. If you miss that, you're solving the wrong problem. Take another example, final example. How many times can you subtract 10 from 100? Instant answer is 10 times because you can subtract it 10 times, right? The unfortunate thing is that once you've taken 10 out of 100, you're not left 100, you're left 90. So you can actually subtract it only once. We miss it because our mind is telling us this is something familiar, I've done it so many times. But the way you look at the question, the way you answer the question, the way you seek the answer changes. A common problem that you will face when you graduate as an MBA is whether to look for a well-paying job or a job that is good for my career. Now we're starting to move into a realm of problems which don't have a straightforward answer and will start affecting you personally. We start having a very, very personal answer. And these questions now require a very different kind of thinking. straightforward answer. Haldiram's known for 87 years, you know, 83 years for the namkeens, suddenly decides that or has suddenly found that, you know, there is a market for healthier food. Now, should they be looking at that as a new market or an existing market that has changed? The kind of question that an MBA student is expected to answer. So all your knowledge of consumer behavior, of market patterns, of competition, of regulatory environments, of consciousness, education, everything will get applied over here. Now, we start getting into a very different kind of problem, which you call real life problems. So from the synthetic problem that you had, which were perfectly given, all the data was there, to problems that now force you to apply multiple kinds of thinking, multiple kinds of knowledge, to something which is far more complex. You know, these are situations where the consequences of making a mistake are very, very serious, you know, preventing nuclear terror and so on and so forth. And then if you're really lucky, and I hope very quickly in your career, you land up with a situation where you're facing the really messed up problems of today. Let me give you an example. You know, we have a problem with obesity. We are becoming bigger and bigger. As a country, as a world, we're becoming bigger and bigger. Our growing bigger problem number one, unfortunately, exists at the same time as our problem of malnourishment. Now, what would you do if you were in a position of authority to do something about one or the other, or ideally both? Can we make our population healthy? Now you're dealing with complexities of the nature that we were talking about. So India is one of the top five in terms of obesity. We are also top five in underweight population. Can you imagine that? What a position to be in. The same country is top five in obesity and top five in malnourishment. And for the first time in 2018, the number of obese people became larger than the number of malnourished people. And if you look at the amount of waste that we have, the amount of food that we waste, just throw it away, allow it to get bad and just throw it away. If we were able to save that food, we could feed our population, our entire population, three times over. That's the amount of food that we're wasting. Now, how do you start solving a problem like this? Is it really the kind of problem that we thought we would be handling? Well, maybe not, but I'm giving you an idea of the scale of the problem that you can handle with design thinking. We started the Swachh Bharat initiative several years ago. We spent huge amount of money in trying to build toilets, and we built toilets because we didn't have them in the first place. And yet, this is the toilet from just about 4 days ago. And less than a week ago, this was a scene in Okhla in Delhi. So has the problem gone away just because we wished it to have gone away? Now, this is where a design thinker would start looking at the problem a little differently. Why do people still prefer to continue with this habit, knowing fully well that there is a toilet which is within walking distance there? And why do people still dirty the toilets the way they do, knowing fully well that, well, you know, that's not what toilets are meant for? And is there a correlation between a toilet being dirty and it not being used and so on and so forth? When you start looking at it from the human perspective, you are starting to understand the power of design thinking. And then, of course, there is a whole range of problems that we prefer not to talk about. And I wish there were more people talking about them. We wish that this was not really true, but we know it is true. We can't really ignore them. These kind of problems are ideal case studies for design thinking. So let's, somewhere along this session, I will take you through several examples of the kind of problem that design thinking is great for. But I hope you've got a base for saying it is something which is used for handling problems which are not really straightforward. You understood my opening and looking at an opportunity for making a difference, not really handling a problem. So here's an opportunity that we will pursue. Now, as you heard me for the last 4 or 5 minutes, the question is, what were you thinking? Now, if you are a real design thinker, the question you would ask is not this one, not what were you thinking, but how are you thinking? What design thinking does is to change the way you think. Not what you think, it's how you think. It changes the way you think about things. And so when we said yesterday design thinking was hidden in the closet and today design thinking is big and is being talked about in the mainstream, what I really want to focus on is not the design part, but on the thinking part. So design thinking is not so much design thinking as in thinking. It's a change in the way you look at the world. And the emphasis is here on thinking. So if you look at yourself in the mirror, remind yourself that there is 6 inches between our ears where all the magic happens. Everything that happens in design thinking happens between those 6 inches, and those 6 inches are invaluable. Only you have them. Now it depends upon how you want to use the 6 inches, entirely up to you. So what is design thinking? There are obviously two parts to design thinking. When you combine them, that's where the magic happens. Fantastic. When you go to Google and say, what is design? You get an answer here. When you go to Google again and say, what is thinking? You get another answer here. What is interesting here is you will not notice, you'll find that neither of these talk about creativity. So everybody used to think design is all about being creative. It's not about being creative. It's applying creativity for a purpose. And so both parts of the brain, the part that is creative and the part that is logical, get applied in solving a problem together. Not creativity alone. In fact, creativity doesn't enter the picture of design thinking at all. You go to Google and ask, what is design thinking? We get about a billion responses. You ask a second question, how to do design thinking? You get about a billion responses. Of design thinking, again, you get about a billion responses. So the good thing about design thinking is there is tons of information available. This is one topic on which there is huge amount of information available on the internet. Also, the bad news, you really don't know where to start. So there are lots of options of design thinking process itself. You ask for design thinking process and you get about 2,500 different ways of doing design thinking. So there's not one single method of doing design thinking either. There are 2,500 different ways of doing design. Again, there's an enormous amount of choice. But the one that is the most popular came from Stanford. They popularized it from 2008 onwards. And this process, it has 5 steps. You have the empathize stage, where you try to understand the problem from a human perspective. You have design, define, which really understands the problem from, you know, the opportunity, the real need that you're trying to service, the real opportunity that you want to focus on. Of course, you generate ideas for potential solutions. And then you create mockups to test out in the field with some of your customers or some of your people that you're designing for. And then you test out your idea in the real environment. Looks linear, but as Vivaldi pointed out in the beginning, it's an iterative process. It's not something which happens linearly. You repeat this process multiple times over. You repeat as many stages as are required. I don't want to go deeper into this because you have a session focused entirely on this 2 days from now. So let's leave this part of the discovery for 2 days from now. But when you look at the process like this, it seems very complex. And so I would urge you to look at this document from Stanford. It's a 5-page manual of design thinking. And you really don't need anything more than this to understand what design thinking is. But this will tell you what design thinking is. It won't tell you how to do it. That's where, you know, support of a learning environment really becomes useful. So what is design thinking? So we've seen what design thinking is, what the steps are, but are we clear about what really it is? It's really the way you frame questions, because if you frame the question correctly, you get the right answer. So 80% of design thinking is asking the right questions. Are we solving the right problem? Are we solving the right problem for the right people? Are we solving it for the right reasons? Do we have the right solution? Will the solution work for the people? Will the solution work in the best possible way? You're always asking yourself these questions, and these questions determine the quality of the answer that you will get. So remember, you're using design thinking for the not so straightforward problems. And so the question also can't be very straightforward. We call this process reframing of the questions. You look at the opportunity, you reframe the question, you reframe the problem again and again until you get to the guts of it. So when you look at the problem and the solution, the thinking that goes behind it, the moment that thinking becomes human-centric, which means we're now trying to look at the effect of the problem on people and the effect of the solution on people, what happens if the problem remains unresolved? What happens if I give this solution? What is going to be the effect of this on the people? Then you have become a design thinker. So the effect on people is what makes this problem-solving approach different from any other. Which is why in design thinking, the first step is empathize. You understand somebody else's perspective. I want to give you a short experience of this. So this is, as we said, the human-centered problem-solving approach, also called design thinking. The reason why this is important is because when you create a solution, sometimes you create new problems. And so in design thinking, you're always looking at the solution and saying, by giving the solution, have I created a new problem for my users? If I have, then the solution is not going to work. And this makes your solution so much more responsible. And so what makes us human in the first place is, first of all, our assumptions. Now, instantly when you read this, you read, says, I'm insulting you. And then you look at it closely and you say, you know, I'm not insulting you. But your instinctive reaction was, I am insulting you. Our own brain tends to read meaning where there is no meaning. You know, so if I show you this random set of characters, the bracket and the circle and all that, suddenly become the face. You know, the emojis came as a result of this. These are just random characters on the keyboard, and yet suddenly it becomes a face. And these faces are how we identify automobiles. Every automobile actually has a face. We have the faces, you know, the faces become mean, they become arrogant and whatever. And these faces tend to lend character to the cars, and therefore we ascribe that same character to the owners as well. Good little, good 500. And what makes us human is the search for security. You know, when we were growing up, we were little children, we loved the security of our parents. And as we grew up, our parents became, you know, the role models that we looked up to. And when somebody at that age asked us, what would you like to be when you grow up? Our instant answer used to be like mama or like papa, you know, depending on who's your favorite parent at that time. And this is natural. And so when parents ask their children, what would you like to be when you sensible parents will keep writing down the answers, because somewhere later on, you know, they'll tell the children, look, when you were little, you wanted to become an astronaut, and then you wanted to become a dancer, and then you wanted to become a doctor, and then you wanted to become something else. This is where the sensitivity to other people becomes significant. I'll take you on a very simple journey here. This journey is in the eastern part of India. Let's ask the same question to somebody in this part of the country. Imagine living in this place. Imagine living there. Imagine that this is the kind of experience you have sometimes when the tornadoes hit you, and when the typhoons hit, and when the rainfall is heavy. I met this little girl called Banita. She's 4 years old. And we became good friends, okay? She didn't understand the Bengali that I knew, because the Bengali I knew, I learned in Kolkata. And where she came from, she spoke a very different dialect, but we became good friends. She's living there all alone, she's a survivor. And I asked this girl, I said, Banita, in my own broken Bengali, what do you want to be when you grow up? And this girl gave a very interesting answer. She said, what do I want to be when I want to grow up? The answer she gave me was, so there is an alternate reality. There is a reality of a human life which is very different from our own. If you can accept that there are people who have a very different life from our own, you become a sensitive person, you become a sensitive design thinker. Here I'm trying to separate the design thinker who works with their heart from a design thinker who merely manages to follow a process, a five-step process, a six-step process. So learning the processes of design thinking does not make you a design thinker. You actually start becoming sensitive to somebody else's reality. The moment you can do that, accept that there is somebody else there, and these people are not to be ignored, they're part of the same world that we live in, I think we would have achieved something unique. This is why design thinking today has become so important, because it is creating more humane managers, it's creating more humane policymakers, it's creating people who are actually making a difference in the world. And so what I want you to remember is that this girl also is on the same planet. Okay, she's part of our life. You can't just ignore it. And you might want to ignore, you might want to turn a blind eye and say, sorry, you know, I just shut my eyes to this, which is fine. But if you can be sensitive, then you've opened up a new door into your own life. And so next time you start looking at your market, don't look at your market as numbers. Don't look at your market as saying there are 30,000 people in this particular, you know, demographic rating and so on who are my customers. Remember that every single customer that you have is first of all a human. And when you start looking at your customers as humans, you start creating better products and better experiences and better solutions for them. This is where a design thinker embedded in an organization can make all the difference, because if you're in HR, you're making a difference to the employees by acknowledging that they are not just employee codes, but they're also human beings. When you are in marketing or in product development or in logistics, you're not looking at the market as numbers, you're looking at the market as human beings. And that difference can be really significant. And so we look at human-centered problem solving not as a problem-solving method. We look at design thinking as an opportunity-finding method. There's an opportunity for making a difference. Let's take examples now. This is from the United Kingdom. Even a place like the UK makes a mistake like this. What do you think is a mistake here? See, your mind responds to images before it starts reading stuff. So your mind is telling you the women's toilet is on the left. And then as you start walking towards that, look, there's something wrong here. And then your mind spends a moment and starts reading and saying, oh. Now imagine every single person who goes to this toilet is now getting confused. A design thinker would never allow this to happen. You have this this the toilet in a petrol pump. It says a toilet here. It has both a man and a woman. But when you walk in there, you expect a toilet to be two separate toilets for men and women. But guess what? There's only one toilet. It has no door. How would a woman feel when she's here? You have toilet. You have a door which says gents toilet, and the gents toilet now has a board which says arrow this way. You start creating these little confusions. You are now identifying opportunities where a difference can be made. Which door should you enter? Which door should you enter? And what's so special about this toilet? This is at the airport. How does a toilet become a gold toilet? It starts generating questions in your mind. What would you throw in this bin? Now, these are tiny examples of design thinking, not applied properly. Let's look at doors. How do you know which way this door will open? Do you push it or you pull it? Have you ever come across a door which you thought would be pushed and you push it and you say, oh. Now, this confusion is so common that people have actually had to write there, this is to be pulled or this is to be pushed. Why are we putting additional load on the brain? Can we avoid that? So you have a door which is to be pushed on one way, pulled on the other. You do the reverse, the door will break. Why are we adding to the stress that people have in their own life anyway? So when you looked at Heinz, you know, Heinz ketchup, is a very popular ketchup. But the problem with the Heinz ketchup is it doesn't flow very freely. So, you know, this is how we would ideally like the ketchup to flow. But invariably what happens when you try to pour a lot, you either get this or you get a real mess. And so Heinz did their own research and figured out, look, one way to ensure that this does not happen is to have the bottle tilted at a particular angle. So they experimented with how to position the sticker in such a way that if you tilted the bottle at the right angle, then the sticker could be read properly. Did it work? It did not work at all. It just did not work at all because this requires cognition. It requires cognitive effort. It requires you to think about something. What worked incidentally was this. Just invert the bottle. Now, it's a breakthrough solution, which is very obvious today. But when it came out, it was really a breakthrough. And this is looking at the way people react to your bottle, how they struggle with the bottle. And once you know how they struggle, the solution seems to be very obvious. So being empathetic towards your consumer created a solution which consumers will then begin to prefer. And this, of course, has become standard from Heinz thereafter. Toothpaste. How much of toothpaste is water? 97% is water. So imagine when you transport a bottle of toothpaste from A to B, you're actually paying for transporting 97% of its weight in water. That's not the whole solution. You have so many different designs of toothbrushes. Every toothbrush manufacturer is trying to compete in a crowded market. So if you had to get into the crowded market and say, I have to now make a difference in this crowded market, how would you differentiate yourself? Every conceivable color of toothbrush exists. Every single configuration of toothbrush already exists. And yet your boss says, I want to enter the toothpaste market. Can I enter this toothpaste market with something? So toothpaste have had a whole range of variants that people have looked for. In fact, when you look at a family, typically no two family members that have a similar kind of toothbrush. They all have their own preferences. You start looking at the way people use toothbrushes. You start looking at the way people have a special need for a toothbrush. Say, every toothbrush cleans the same way, the same way. Is there some other dimension on which I can compete? I obviously can't produce a toothbrush that cleans better than anybody else because I know that part has been taken care of. Second way I can look at this is to say, what are the impact of toothbrushes on the environment? So when a toothbrush goes bad, we throw away the entire toothbrush, even though just the bristles have gone bad. So the amount of waste that we're throwing away every 3 to 6 weeks when we discard a used toothbrush is phenomenal. So do we really have to throw away the entire toothbrush? That's how you're starting to think now. This is no reason for you to throw a toothbrush away. So can we now have detachable toothbrushes where you just replace the part that you need to replace so your environmental impact is lower? Can we now start replacing the plastic part with something which is biodegradable? And then can we even make the bristles replaceable? And this is bamboo bristles, by the way, which you can replace in about 10 seconds on a used toothbrush. So there is fresh thinking going along. But even more important is the way people struggle with certain toothbrushes. So I said, why do we need toothpaste? Because toothpaste is all water. Why can't you have a little tablet which you just put on the brush and you start brushing it, and it uses the saliva to generate all the lather that you want? And suddenly what you've done is you've actually taken away 48% of the cost of logistics and almost 70% of the cost of the material out of the toothpaste. Toothpaste tube that costs you typically about 70 to 80 rupees a tube. Now the same quantity, the same number of brushings, you can do in about 18 paise. That's the difference, 1/8. Is that good for you? There are people who struggle to hold a toothbrush because of arthritis and because their hands are no longer as young as they were. What can we do about them? Can we enable them to also brush their teeth? The answer is yes. And so different experimentations done during a project, which you can see on the left, resulted in what we call the universal toothbrush. Anybody can hold it, from a two-year-old kid learning how to brush all the way up to a 97-year-old mother, grandmother who wants to brush her teeth. Everybody can use it. And if you ask yourself, you would also enjoy using a brush like this. It's very comfortable in your hands. And then brushes which fall out of the hands, can we do something about them? And then we are teaching children to brush for exactly 2 minutes. And you build a timer into the toothbrush itself. So you keep brushing as long as the music keeps playing. You know, such an easy solution. There are times when we've not liked our hair and we use a hairbrush. And every young lady who brushes her hair knows that at some stage that brush has to be cleaned. So if I have to get into the hairbrush market, do I create a hairbrush which actually becomes, which actually brushes better, or I take care of a human problem? So we were told to wash our hands, right, COVID. The problem we did not take care of was, does everybody have access to running water? Easy to say everybody should wash their hands as frequently as possible. Where's the running water? Where is the soap? When you start looking at the consequences of some of these decisions, I think we have a very, very interesting set of opportunities. So I can just go on and on. But I think by now you've got a feel for what kind of problems design thinking is able to address and how it's able to actually manage that. Tomorrow, when you start looking at offering yourself in the job market as a candidate, and you say that, look, I do understand what design thinking is. Don't make the mistake of saying, I know the design thinking process. Because design thinking is not a process. It's actually a mindset. It's the way you think. So when you're waiting for your interview and you're telling people, hire me, I think the important question is, how confident are you in saying, I don't have the answer. I don't know. But I do have something which is magical in the middle, in between my ears, and I know how to allow that to work. And so, though I don't know how this will be done, I don't know the answer to this, I know how I will get the answer. I know there is a method of getting at the answer, and I will get the answer. The moment we are that positive, I think we become differentiated in a whole different league. It doesn't matter what you know. If you're able to demonstrate that I can apply what I know differently or better from somebody else, in that competition gets blown away. My closing thought here is, remember, every challenge is actually an opportunity. So don't shy away, don't get afraid of facing challenges which appear to be daunting. Let's give it a try. Let's do something about it. And then remember, there's somebody who's banking on you, somebody who really doesn't have anybody looking out after them. They're banking on you. Great, let me stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Guy. That was really very interesting and quite illuminating as well. So really, thank you very much.